My earliest memory of Oakland music is Drew Downs. Oh, no, Hammer. I would say Hammer. Hammer is my earliest memories. Can't touch this. The MC Hammer cartoon.
You can't touch this. You can't touch this. You can't touch this.
Music has been a part of, you know, Oakland life, you know, my entire life. You know, I used to go to drum circles when I was little. You know, I'm from the boombox era, so cats used to play music loud everywhere. Like, I remember going to the lake every weekend, and, you know, people roller skating and playing music.
Oakland, it's as gorgeous as, like, the people and the style and the water and the redwood trees and, like, how clean the air is. But it's also kind of grimy and has a hard edge to it.
Well, I sold tapes every day, me and Freddie B. Been famous since 1983. Oakland, you know I go way back to Coug Nuts, Fox Stangs, and Cadillac. When homeboys put
Oakland's music has always been a rebel. Oakland music has always been creative. Oakland's music has always been music, especially 7th Street style music. It's always been something that was created in a club, something that was created from people booing you. It's always been created from the heart, from an artistic standpoint.
Oakland has so much music history, and I know some of it, but as I've been diving deeper into it, I was shocked at how far back this shit go.
Every day I had a blue.
Oakland is dumbass small. It's not like New York or Los Angeles. But when it comes to music, you would think it was a major city in terms of the impact the town has had nationally and internationally.
And it'd be hell wild, bro. Cause we both some music heads. And then we is both realizing how so much music history has its roots in Oakland. My introduction to Oakland music was too short. I remember sneaking around and looking at my dad's CD collection, and I see the CD, and the image was a nigga looking like he on some player shit, and I'm like, I gotta play this. I remember waiting for my parents to go to sleep, and I put that thing in my little boombox, and I started playing it. So for me, Too Short's Getting Where You Fit In, that was my first memory.
Now you're hardcore like CB4, fighting what you wanna be me for, it's your life. You wish you was a Too Short rap, but you got no game and your bass ain't fat. You need to quit. Rapping just ain't.
When it comes to Oakland music, a memory that sticks out to me was finding one of my dad's old cassette tapes and seeing him look all grimy on the cover. Real 90s street rap. My pops is an artist too, and he still produces to this day. He had a record deal at one point, so a lot of this music culture is in my blood. But one of my best music-related memories growing up had to be going to my first party in middle school. My granny dropped me off. I walked up the apartment building steps, and as soon as I got through the door, boom! Instantly getting twerked on. As a teenager, there really was nothing like Oakland house parties.
This is Tales of the Town. I'm Abbas Muntakim.
And I'm Delincy Parham. Today on the show, if you can't tell already, we talking Oakland music. And I really need all our listeners to understand just how juiced I am for this episode. We were really able to interview some town legends, from Guapale to Tajay of Souls of Mischief and Hieroglyphics, to local heroes like D-Naz and Tim House. There's so much history here that we could dedicate 100 episodes to it. But for now, we broke it up into two.
Yo.
So turn your volume up and get ready to rock with us on this episode of Tales of the Town.
Hyphy, what it do? The Sheezy,
that's my word.
We're all records, baby. Dope Game 2.
So if you remember, on episode 1 of Tales of the Town, we talked about the Great Migration and our Southern roots.
Our elders, they had a lot of Southern culture that they brought with them too. And once they was in Oakland, they put their own twist on it.
Black Southerners have always created, even with the oppression of white supremacy against them. Music was one of the many ways black folks in the South expressed themselves, and many of the genres we all love, like rock and roll and blues, have their roots in the South, and it was black people who created them.
And folks love crediting Elvis as if Chuck Berry, a black man, wasn't the father of rock and roll.
It was a teenage wedding and the old folks wished him well. You could see that Pierre did truly love the mademoiselle. And now the young monsieur and madame have rung the chapel bell. C'est la vie, say the old folks, it goes to show you never can tell.
Blues? Our people invented that genre, despite existing in some of the most horrific conditions of the Jim Crow South. Our ancestors found a way to share their pain in a manner that healed themselves and their community. And in the process of doing this, gave birth to music that has influenced the sounds that we still hear today.
It's been a long, long time since I first fell in love with you.
And as our southern elders and ancestors fled to Oakland, they also brought their southern music culture with them. West Oakland specifically is where they turned a street not on a 7th Street into a hub for black musicians. We were lucky enough to be able to tap in with Ronnie Stewart, who was the founder of the West Coast Blues Society.
7th Street is known for its entertainment district. 7th Street is referred to by some writers and musicologists, the Harlem of the West Coast.
7th Street was a vital part of black life in Oakland as black folks fled the terrors of the Jim Crow South. 7th Street operated as a black nation within the redlined area of West Oakland. Not only was it a music hub, but it was a vital economic hub for the black community as well.
Around the 30s and the 40s, it sort of, because of the war years, it turned into a black mecca. We had a Bank of America, we had a pool room, we had numerous soul food and southern cuisine restaurants. We had a doctor's office, dentist's office, attorney office. It was a place to meet, greet.
And it was a place where you might find you a new Oakland boo thing.
They didn't have online dating then, but you can have your date night. You can meet them that night, and you can act as if you've been married for 100 years. But anyway.
7th Street was a place where black businesses thrived, and it was at the center of the music culture of Oakland.
7th Street was important in a lot of ways. First of all, it was a black community with black businesses. 90% of the businesses were black. The theater was owned by Italians, the Lincoln Theater, but the Lincoln Theater was very important because Slim Jenkins would book artists like Billie Holiday, Cab Calloway, and his club was too small. So he would rent the Lincoln Theater out for the night, and he would have the people come down to the Lincoln Theater to see Billie Holiday and Cab Calloway and Duke Ellington, the big bands.
It's hard to imagine now, especially as 7th Street, as it once was, has been dilapidated by gentrification. But can you imagine seeing some of the biggest artists at that time right in the middle of West Oakland?
The importance of 7th Street is people like B.B. King, T-Bone Walker, Lowell Folsom, Etta James. They all, between L.A. and Oakland, cut their teeth. So 7th Street played a big role in how they do their show, how they create their originals.
If you can't tell by now, Ronnie is gamed up on a lot of 7th Street history, and he even had a story about a young artist performing on 7th Street that was told to him by B.B. King's brother.
B.B. King's brother Billy told me a story. He said they were walking into a Slim Jenkins, and this young girl was running late, so she ran over B.B. King's shoe, and she turned around and said, "Oh, I'm sorry, Mr. King, I'm so sorry. I really didn't mean to. Please forgive me." So she bent down. She was finna, like, brush his shoes off, and he grabbed her by the shoulder and said, "Now, You know, I know your father, Aretha, Reverend Franklin. It was Aretha Franklin. So she was like 16, 17. So when he would be at the Oakland Auditorium, which is known as the Henry J. Kaiser, when he'd be doing revivals, Aretha would come down there to Slim Jenkins and sing and make a little change and go back, you know. So B.B. King, frequently Aretha Franklin opened up for him at Slim Jenkins. And that just goes to show you the level of entertainment that was at Slim Jenkins.
So as you can see, some of the biggest and best names of jazz, blues, and rock and roll, they made their way through West Oakland. And although 7th Street is filled with all this deep foundational history, for some reason, it just doesn't get the same recognition as Motown or Harlem for its role in early sound development of these genres and the culture that was created. Ronnie spoke to the originality of the music that was coming out of Oakland.
When you hear a band from Oakland, they always had horns. When you hear a band from Chicago, they had harmonicas. When you hear a band from Oakland, they had that, you know. When you hear a band from Chicago, the biggest influx of people that came to Oakland, West Oakland, 7th Street, was Louisiana, Texas, and Oklahoma. The ones from Chicago, they came from mostly Mississippi and Alabama. And so our sound was a mixture of all kinds of sounds.
And the mixture of all these sounds Ronnie was talking about, they were perfected inside of venues on 7th Street.
It's always been something that was created in a club, something that was created from people booing you. It's always been created from the heart, from an artistic standpoint.
And we like to believe that the reason 7th Street isn't getting the recognition of a Motown or Harlem is because the city of Oakland has made little effort to support locals like Ronnie and his West Coast Blues Society group in their fight to preserve and amplify the history of 7th Street. On 7th Street, all they have is the old Esther's Orbit Room marquee and a few Walk of Fame stars. While in Detroit, there's a whole museum for Motown dedicated to the achievements and people that it birthed. And Harlem, despite the gentrification that the area has experienced, you can still see and feel the remnants of its historic music culture. They have the Jazz Museum, and even the legendary Apollo Theater is still up and running. Urban renewal and gentrification, they have almost completely erased Black Oakland's heavy contribution to the music scene. But the historical significance of 7th Street, it cannot be understated.
In a previous episode, we talked about the Black Panther Party and its free breakfast program, as well as how COINTELPRO destroyed the Panthers. What we didn't talk about is the Panthers' contribution to soul and funk music and how the Black Panther Party led to an overall cultural shift in music. We sat down with Ricky Vincent, a lecturer at UC Berkeley who has documented how the Black Power movement helped transform soul music.
I grew up around the movements in the 70s, and so as I dug into the music, I realized that movements for Black freedom were overlapping with the musical movements. And that led me to explore the cultural production of the Black Panther Party. And that led me to discover that the Black Panther Party, while they always had outdoor festivals and gatherings and demonstrations, and they always used public spaces very well, they also had their own rhythm and blues band.
So for those of you who don't know, the Black Panther Party had their own band called the Lumpen. The Panthers were big on developing revolutionary culture, and music was a huge part of that. Emory Douglas, who was the Minister of Culture, he advocated for the creation of a band to push the party's politics.
And in 1970, they put a group together, asked for volunteer musicians, backup musicians, and that was not hard to find back then. It's easy to find black musicians all around the area. Most of these people were recently out of high school, and most of the songs they played were songs off the radio. The music was songs off the radio, but then they reinvented the lyrics to represent the revolutionary positions that the party was taking.
They made songs like No More, which was a soulful track with the political call to the end of oppression, and songs like Free Bobby Now, which advocated for co-founder Bobby Seale's freedom.
This music was the pulse of the party. It got people engaged and politicized in a way that was natural to them. You didn't have to attend a speech from Bobby Seale to get politicized. All you had to do was throw a record on by the Lumpen.
The cultural impact of the Panthers went beyond their on-the-ground organizing. The music they made began to impact the entire industry to where you can see a clear shift in what artists were talking about.
And so the movement was transforming Black America, period. And Black artists were shedding their conformist sensibilities. And it's symbolized by them shedding the pressed uniforms and slacks and the formal look that was designed to, you know, incur acceptance from white America.
The cultural shift that the Panthers created allowed for black artists to be able to make music that reflected the times.
So the Black Panthers set a tone in the Bay Area in the late 60s for how to get down, for how to be black, for how to be black and proud, if you will. The Black Panthers weren't really talking that. They were doing that. And people understood it. People felt it. Whether or not they played a note, people understood that black self-image was changing as black self-determination was emerging. That wasn't about, you know, reactionary race hatred, that type of thing. They were well past that.
Ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, the Black Panther Party very proudly presents the Lumpen!
Just on this history of soul music alone, you can see how influential Oakland has been to music. This revolutionary culture of self-determination that was developed by the Panthers, it laid a strong foundation for future generations of Oakland music.
Next Tales of the Town, part two of the music episode. We talk about the cultural impact of artists like Guapalé on the youth of Oakland, and how artists like Hieroglyphics and Keek the Sneak made a name for themselves.
We made the song 91 Till Infinity on some chill shit, like just how we be chilling earlier. We didn't actually complete the song, it was just a concept. And so we were like, let's call this one 93 Till Infinity. And then it just grew to, let's call the album 93 Till Infinity. I guess one of the strongest songs we've created.
That's next on Tales of the Town. And one last thing. In addition to the podcast, we've teamed up with artists from all over the Bay Area to produce 11 original songs for the Tales of the Town album. All proceeds from the music go towards supporting people's programs. Here's a preview of Party with the Gang, featuring G-Eazy, P-Lo, and Fredo Bags, releasing this Friday.
Yeah, new Patek, I'm in effect, on flagrant, disrespect, getting sex, yeah, she's a crew banger, that mean the whole crew could bang her. She just wanna know what it's like, she just wanna party for a night, ay, she just wanna try new things, she just wanna, she just wanna party with the gang, party with the gang, party with the gang, ay. She just wanna party with the gang, party with the gang, party with the gang,
party with the gang, ay. She just wanna party with the gang. Hey, say she like the ice up on these chains. Throwing ones when we walk in the club, we make it rain. VIP with players in the thugs, you with the lanes.
Say she like my vibe, come and throw it back.
Tales of the Town is hosted and executive produced by me, Delincy Parham, and Abbas Muntakim. Our senior producer is Maya Cueva. Fact checking done by Bashir Mack and Danya Soliman. Mixing and sound design is done by Pat Masidi Miller and Lauren Newsom. The theme song was produced by Cheyenne G and Carrie Lynn, with additional instrumentals from Chef Lee.
If you like what you heard in this episode, check the description to find links to the music. You can find out more about Professor Ricky Vincent's work through his book titled Party Music: The Inside Story of the Black Panthers Band and How Black Power Transformed Soul Music. To support Ronnie Stewart's work to preserve the musical history of 7th Street in West Oakland, visit westcoastbluessociety.org. If you enjoyed Tales of the Town, please give us that 5-star review and make sure to subscribe to wherever you get your podcast at.
And it was a place where you might find you a new Oakland boo thing. One of those has to be it. Okay. But anyways.